episode of SNU Variety on Channel 22. I'm your host, Owen White, and I'd just like to start off by saying that this is SNU's first TV show, television show, just so you know, I don't write this stuff, okay? I am reading off a teleprompter here, and I'm reading what it says, and someone else writes this stuff for me, so when I sound retarded, I'm not actually, okay? Just thought I'd let you know that. Let's continue, shall we? Last time I said that this was the first TV show ever. Well, it's not, as you may know, nor is it the first episode. It is the fifth. And I'll admit, though I am superior, I made a mistake. I don't want to talk about it, okay? So how about you stop judging me, alright? I really wish all you folks would leave me alone. I'd also like to say that there are 6 weeks of school left, and 5, not counting finals week, before after this week. And I have one more show after this episode. But today we have Jock Talk with Chase Buchanan, interviewing the most important coach in the world. I don't remember his name, though. We also have with us today the man who plays the part of a sad Frenchman in this year's Joseph the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, Jack Nance. We will then take you to a world of the unknown, unheard of, and with unimportant people. That's right, the wide world of humans, with our favorite man, who can hold a mic in his hand and stand in the same time? Ryan Evans. Of course, that's not all. Jeff White, who again is not a kin of mine, is on the same lookout he has been on for the past 5 weeks, besides a date. And unlike the first option, he has found another hot topic with the search. We then leave you with a tasty portion of Strangers with Candy. But first, my friends, we have collected many votes and have recounted fairly for this week's top 10 list. The top 10 things to replace the centennial fountain with. Number 10, a large shrubbery in the shape of President Gresham's statue. And along with the shrubbery, we would have a very large herring with which you could cut down the mightiest tree in the forest. Number 9, a Ferris wheel. No longer would we congregate around the Centennial Plaza or in the lobbies of the dorms, or even around like Holder Closer. No, we would be making out in high altitudes. Number 8, a rock climbing wall. Who needs a rock climbing wall when you have the prayer chapel? Number 7, a petting zoo. Ah, yes, we would go around the campus gathering all the little cute squirrels, put them in a nice fence. You can go in there and pet the squirrel, but if you get your hand bitten off or if you get rabies, the school's not responsible. Number 6, a moonwalk. Like I said before, I don't write this stuff. Number 5, putt-putt. For those of you who are Southerners and like to call it putt-putt, I would like for you to know... that us cool Yankees like to call it miniature golf. Number 4, a performing arts center. Now, I think you've seen how big the Centennial Fountain is, and I'm thinking that the performing arts center would be pretty small. In fact, I think you'd probably have a soapbox, and then everyone would have to sit down on the little carpet squares so that you could watch the production. I don't know how much fun that is. Number 3, a giant Bible. That would be great, except for the fact that everyone would be trying to figure out what translation would be best. As far as I'm concerned, I just want to have the red lettering. And number 2, a huge hot tub. No longer would SNU students have to break into the apartment complexes to have their hot tubbing pleasures. No, we have it right here on campus. And number 1, Krispy Kreme donuts. I'm all about Krispy Kreme donuts, I like them very much, but I think we can forget about the freshman 15. After one semester here at SNU, we would all be able to be sumo wrestlers. Ladies and gentlemen, your top 10 list. Now, we take you to SNU Variety Sports Haven with our heavenly host, Chase Buchanan. Monsieur Buchanan has captured SNU's girls basketball coach, Craig Wigg. He'll be asking Coach Wigg some stuff about the girls, the basketball team. Here's Jock Talk.
Hello, welcome to this week's edition of Chalk Talk. Today, we have Coach Wigg, coach of the SNU women's basketball team, with us today. Coach, thanks for joining us.
You're welcome.
Congratulations this season. You guys had a really good season, made it all the way to the finals. Came up a little short, but first we're going to go ahead and jump in to how you came to SNU and where you went to school, where you played basketball, and just tell us a little bit on how you got interested in the sport and how you came here to SNU.
Okay. You're wanting to go way back then, aren't you?
Way back.
Well, I tell you what, I just finished my eighth year at SNU, and two of those years I was a graduate assistant or volunteer assistant with the men's program while I continued to teach at UConn High School. Mm-hmm. And been 8 great years, 6 years as the women's head coach, something that has been even more special than I ever dreamed it would be. I love coaching the game. I've had an opportunity and have been blessed through the years that I played, that I was coached by coaches that not only were good coaches, but they were good teachers of the game. So I've always had an opportunity when I was playing to play for coaches that were good teachers, and I learned an awful lot during the time I was playing. The University of Oklahoma, I had an opportunity the last 2 years I was there to play for Dave Bliss, who is now the head coach at Baylor University. But Coach Bliss was a great great motivator, but he was also a great teacher of the game. And so I learned an awful lot as a player, and then I was very fortunate to stay on 2 years as a graduate assistant coach with him and learned an awful lot those 2 years. Spent about 9 years teaching and coaching at the high school level here in Oklahoma at Norman High School in Choctaw, and then out at UConn High School. And so I look back and I remember probably each of those situations. You know, God used those situations to teach me a lot of different things about how to coach kids, how to teach kids, how to use those opportunities as ministry opportunities. And so I'm very, very fortunate that I have an opportunity to do something today, and that somebody actually pays me to do something that I really, really enjoy doing on a daily basis, and really thrilled to be here.
Well, getting paid is a plus.
Absolutely.
Well, from going from the University of Oklahoma and Choctaw and coaching at the high school level, you've had an opportunity to coach at several different schools. Tell us a few of your relationships that you've had with students and other coaches that you've coached with, and what a blessing they've been on you.
Well, you know, I think some of those that come to mind real quick for me are when I was out at UConn High School. There was a guy there, Jerry Johnson, who was an assistant coach for Terry Dean before I ever arrived there. And Jerry stayed on as my assistant coach while I was there. And I think one of the biggest things I learned from Jerry was just was loyalty and a tremendous love for the game. Here's a guy who has been teaching and coaching in UConn for many, many years, and probably had lots of opportunities to go other places as a head coach, but was very satisfied to be in a position that allowed him to, allowed him to teach, but allowed him to motivate kids and relate to kids, you know. And so I've always looked at Jerry as somebody that kind of epitomized, what coaching was all about from a standpoint of relationship with kids. You know, the time I've been here, I think Bobby Martin is somebody that I look to as somebody who has always seen what he does here at the university and his mission, or his part in the university as an important part of the mission of this university. And so I appreciate Bobby and the way that he encourages me, my assistants, and my kids in our program. And so I love the fact that I can coach at a place where they allow me to encourage me to have a ministry through my program.
The first year you came here, the girls' basketball team already had a pretty successful program. How did you get the girls to buy into your way of coaching and buy into your idea of thinking and playing?
Well, I think more than anything else, I think one of the things that I did coming in, and I talked to Jerry Fickbiter a little before, you know, before I took the job. I also talked to some other coaches, Coach Bliss and some others who had been a part of or had walked into situations with had been successful, and, you know, how to go about that. And I think one of the things that was kind of universal in their advice was that if it's not broken, you know, don't fix it. And one of the things that I realized real quick about the kids that I had coming back in 96, 97 was that I had a nucleus of seniors, you know, people like Astud Njai and Gayla Smith, who had been integral parts of three straight national championship teams, who knew how to play the game, who knew how to compete, and knew how to win. You also had some kids on that team like Sherry Ferries and Sandy Macias, who were kids that didn't play a whole lot but had been around and understood the importance or the important intangible things that it took in order to win. So it was really important for me to draw on those kids right off the bat, right from the beginning, give them a lot of input into what we were doing. But I think one of the things that I tried really hard to do was not change a lot of things, leave some things the way they were. We did a lot of things offensively and defensively and philosophically that weren't a whole lot different from what they'd been doing the year before. And what it did is it allowed Gayla and Astu and these other girls to be themselves, continue to compete, not have to do a lot of make a lot of changes for me. Probably the only thing that I did that was probably a whole lot different than what they'd done before was probably played a lot more man-to-man defense, and I emphasized that a little bit more. And I think in the long run it helped us a little bit. But I think more than anything else, probably not changing a lot of things was really fortunate or was really helpful for us that first year.
In college basketball, you deal with freshmen coming in that just graduated from high school. In professional sports, you really don't have to deal with that kind of a thing. With a successful program like we have here at SNU that you had with the women's basketball team, when you get new freshmen in, what's the first thing you say to them to let them feel relaxed? That way they don't look like a deer in the headlights kind of thing when they first come in here, and that way they're not so overwhelmed with all the success.
Well, I think, we've been real fortunate in that, at least in the time I've been here, we haven't had to rely on freshmen that much as major contributors to what we do. Probably in 96, 97, Leanne Besner and Sherry Lehrling were two kids that two freshmen we had to rely on quite a bit. And then this last year, Katie Snodgrass and Christy Rush and Julie Fulbright were freshman kids that we had to rely on a lot. But it's really just been in recent years that we've had to kind of, you know, incorporate our freshmen quickly and get them acclimated to what we're doing and get them going. I don't know that you can ever get past the freshman jitters, but I think one of the things that we try to do here is we do a really good job. My assistant coaches are real important in this. Do a really good job of emphasizing the process, which is for us the process is really what you do on a day-to-day basis in practice. I believe with all my heart the game itself is played on the floor, and you know, I think if you watch me coach a lot of times during a game, I try really hard to stand back and let the kids play. You know, you don't if there's adjustments that need to be made, we'll make them, but I don't think I go in thinking that I'm going to have to make a lot of changes during the game, because the process for us is having really solid, consistent practices all week, and we feel like if we do that, then when we get to the game will take care of itself. And I think our freshmen buy into that a little bit, and they practice really hard, and they work hard in practice, and then when the game comes, it's kind of, this is what we do. We try to do it just like practice.
You mentioned Katie Snodgrass. She was on here last week, and she had nothing but nice things to say about your program and nice things to say about you. Tell us how she fit into your program. You mentioned that you relied on her quite a bit. She was SAC Conference Freshman of the Year. Tell us how she fit in with your program and what she meant to your team.
You know, Katie did a great job, and I'm sure she said nice things because she's a freshman and she has three more years to go and she wants to keep her scholarship. But Katie did an outstanding job, and I tell you, you know, a while ago you and I were talking off camera about the things that we look for when we're looking at recruits, and Katie was one of those kids that we saw had a talent and ability to push the basketball up the floor from the point guard position and get the ball to other people, you know, in such a way that most high school players can't. And she did some things that I saw that you really can't teach. And that was one of the first things that drew me to her. She also was a highly competitive kid, a tough-minded kid, And I just felt like from the first time I saw her, she'd be somebody that would fit in well with what we do here. And she's done that. I mean, she's come in. She had a veteran point guard ahead of us in Heather Mason McNutt, who had started for us the year before. And so right off the bat, I think a little bit of the pressure was taken off Katie from the standpoint of that she knew she had a solid point guard ahead of her, somebody that wasn't threatened by Katie's talent, but was willing to help Katie learn and be a mentor for her. And I think you got to give Heather McNutt a lot of credit for how quickly Katie has come along and developed as a player. But she did an outstanding job, and as you said, was freshman of the year in our conference. I think you got to give a lot of praise to Christy Rush, too, because here's another girl that was a true freshman that came in and finished second in the voting, in fact, in our conference for freshman of the year. So we had two outstanding freshmen, and we were very fortunate. We're very proud that they're here.
So this year's team was a young team, and we're going to be looking really good later on also in future seasons ahead. Tell us a little bit about what happened this season, the things you guys achieved, the goals you achieved, and the goals you're going to be setting for next season also.
Well, I know that it's a little different maybe than a lot of other programs, and as I mentioned before we started, you look back at the coaches that have been here before, Bob Hoffman and Jerry Finkbeiner, and the great players who were here, Katrina Springer and Joanna Brady, and great coaches and players, Sherilyn Morris, Astunin Jai, Julia Yusanova. Those players built a foundation set the groundwork for this program. And there's a lot of teams that go into the season and their goals may revolve around having a winning season or maybe getting to the national tournament. And as I said beforehand, I think one of the things that's happened for us is that we just finished going to our 10th straight Final Four. And that should be a keynote accomplishment, but at the same time, because we've been fortunate enough to do it consistently for a number of years, it's become kind of the norm for us. And our goals really center more around winning a national championship. It's been, 97 was the last year we won a national championship. So our goals going into this year really revolved around, getting to the national title game and winning a national championship. And, we had a really outstanding early season. We didn't play particularly well in the Capital City Classic in December, but we went into the Christmas break with an 8-2 mark, came out of that, went to Houston, and played really two outstanding games in Houston right after the Christmas break. And I felt like kind of turned a corner. I felt like our young kids grew up a lot. We began to play really, really consistently on the defensive end of the floor. And, we proceeded to go 16-2 in the conference race. And, easily the toughest conference in the country. I was very proud. I think if you'd have told me ahead of time we could go 16-2, I'd have been happy. I wasn't. In the end, it cost us a conference championship or a tie for a conference championship losing to OCU in the last conference game. But we went to Lubbock, played very well in the conference tournament, beat OCU in the finals of the conference tournament, and won that championship. Went to Jackson, Tennessee, to the national tournament with a lot of confidence, and thought we played really, really well in the national tournament. Early in the game against OCU and then in the title game, probably had about an 8-minute stretch where we didn't play particularly well, and kind of dug ourselves a hole. And ultimately, we were able to cut it to a 17-point deficit to 3 points in the last minute, but couldn't quite get over the hump. And so, disappointing way to end when your goals are to win it. Right. But at the same time, I'm very, very proud of the kids and what they did accomplish this year, and feel really good. We had two outstanding seniors in Jamie Crane and Tiffany Moore, who were great leaders for us. They'll be missed. Jamie was here 5 years. Tiffany was a junior college transfer, and both of them were very meaningful members of our program and our team, and we'll miss them. But I'm excited. I told somebody the other day, I think in the 6 years I've been the women's coach here, it's probably the first time I've ever had a team come back from Jackson angry. And, we've been disappointed other times, but this team was angry, and I feel really good about, their attitude right now. They're eager to start. We start our off-season stuff next Monday. So I believe we have an opportunity, next year and the year after to be good once again. And I think this team with a little maturity, a lot of off-season workouts and strength conditioning, I think this team has an opportunity to do some special things the next 2 years.
Well, Coach, great season. Congratulations. Thanks for coming on the show. Be sure to tune in next week. We'll have a great show, and now I'm going to send you back to SNU Variety.
Thanks, CB. Tonight's guest needs no introduction if he is your roommate, if he sings in your choir, if he sits next to you, or if he is your cousin, because he's related to half the students here. He hates bad breath, and he is from Houston, Texas, and he's a very good friend of mine when at gunpoint. Please give a warm welcome to SNU's anti-halitosis Texan, Mr. Jack Nance. Hello, Jack. Thank you for coming on your show today.
Thank you for having me.
No problem. Always a pleasure.
You dropped those.
Oh, why thanks.
I think I did too.
Anyway, Jack, everywhere I go, I cannot help but hear about an anti-halitosis theory. I was wondering if you'd explain that for me.
There are many different types of phobia, Owen. Afraid of spiders, afraid of the dark, afraid of feet, which I know a certain girl that is afraid of feet. She plays violin or viola, one of the two. I've got a phobia of bad breath. Everywhere I go, I always have a peppermint handy or in my mouth or in my pocket or in my hand. Well, my phobia is, do I have bad breath? And I hate other people. I don't hate them. I hate it when other people have bad breath. It's just something I can't stand. It's really important to me.
Do you have a mint on you now?
No. They're in my bag over there, if you want one.
I don't need one.
Okay. I believe I don't need
it. You saying I do?
No. Can't smell your breath.
That's probably a good thing.
All right.
You are on U Singers.
I am on U Singers. This is my third year, my sixth semester. I sing bass. I'm pretty happy with it.
Okay.
I'm liking it.
And
aren't you in choir, too?
I am in choir. I'm in the SNU chorale, and I'm a tenor, which just happens to be the best part ever.
Really?
Yes. Without the tenors, any choir, would not be present. We make the choir.
Gotcha. Well, bass just happens to be the easiest and best. So, next question.
Yeah, you're in a musical. It is called
Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat.
And what part do you play in that?
Amazing, my friend. I play Simeon. He's the second oldest brother. Reuben, Simeon, and then the other 10, I guess. I'm Simeon, and the solo I have, I sing those canon days, which is a French solo. I enjoy it. Last year, I feel I did pretty well. I got a lot of compliments. This is the second year we're doing it.
Why?
Why? We got great reviews last year. And not only with the great reviews, the record for the music department, it went so high. Like, we sold out almost every show. We had a bunch of matinees and just pretty much the reviews part. And SNU is not only concerned for our education, it is also a business. And so they like the more money, it's pretty good. And heck, I'd be the same way.
Probably
make some more money, too.
Yeah. This is the first time that that's ever happened, right? Where they've done a show two times a year.
I believe so. As far as I know, yeah.
Okay. Here at school, what is your major?
My major. I am a mass communications broadcast journalism major. I have a minor in music. I wouldn't normally have a minor, but being a mass communication major, you need to have a minor. I don't know why, but since I am in choir, I am involved in music, might as well just minor in music. And so all next year, all my senior year, I'm just taking mostly music classes. It'll be all right.
Okay, we've discussed U Singers. Are there any other extracurricular activities that you do?
Yes. I have a program that I am in charge of, somewhat. It's for students, for the student body. And that's pretty much it.
Does it have a name?
Yeah.
Do you want to tell us the name?
It's called Southern Nazarene University Varied Itty.
Varied Itty.
Yes.
That sounds very interesting.
Yes.
I wish I could be a part of something like that.
I think you do a fantastic job.
Thank you. And so your future, after you get out of school, which will be in how many years, do you think?
Five.
Okay. What do you plan on doing?
I plan on being a producer for a TV show. If not TV, then I guess the dream would be going into films in Hollywood, putting more of a basis on the Christian film industry, because the Christian industry and all forms of entertainment, it's booming. It's getting really big.
It is.
Yeah, I'm liking that.
And would you call your show Veridity?
No. If I ran a show, it would probably be because it's already going on, and I would just take control because I'm strong-willed like that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a hot mother party hype.
Hot mother party hype. I've never heard those words put together before.
That's me. I'm original, I'm different, I'm all about change. Leave me alone.
Okay. You are a fourth generation person here.
I am fourth generation. My parents weren't here as well as my grandparents and their parents. In fact, I am not related to half the students here. I'm related to five. It used to be seven, but two of them moved away. Cousins. You know, I'm mm-hmm. the only child. Snowbarger Hall, the freshman boys' dorm. It was named after my great grandpa's brother, George Snowbarger, because back when the school was like in debt, it was about to go under. He mortgaged his house, I think, and then it pretty much saved the university from closing, I think, and so they finally built another dorm, and they named it after him.
Which was Bracken or Snowbarger?
It was Bracken.
Okay.
No, it was Snowbarger. Sorry. It was Snowbarger. His name was George Snowbarger.
And you're related to Snowbarger?
Through a very long line. Like, way, way up there. It's up there.
I see. You know, you and I are related.
Probably.
I don't know how, but...
More than likely.
Way, way back in that line, I'm sure.
Back in the day.
Yeah, something like that. Now, everybody knows you, the staff. Is that true?
Oh, only because my parents went here. Like, half the people, like, I'll come in each semester. Excuse me. I'll come in each semester in a different class, and most of my professors say, "Are you John and Rena's boy?" Yeah. Tell them I said hello. They're a crazy, kooky couple. How are they doing? All right. Either, if not, my professors, just different staff. Like my advisor, Dr. Pam Broyles, she was good friends with both my parents. They graduated the same class, I believe, 78. I could be wrong. But they were good friends. Dr. Hackler, Gwen Hackler, she was Gwen Ladd, I believe, at the time, when she went to school here. She knew my parents. I don't know how well of friends they were, but I talked to her once, and she said, yeah, she knew my parents pretty well. And most of the staff who know my parents, they say, tell them I said hi. I remember this one time, and then they go off on a story that has absolutely nothing to do with me, nor do I care to hear it. And I never have said, hey, so-and-so says hi. They wanted me to tell you the story. Sorry, I have a few people.
Maybe the staff that have told you these things maybe aren't going to pretend to know you anymore because of what you said today.
Maybe. I might just have dropped some of my grades. A letter grade. Or two. But then we go to Christian University and not too many people would take advantage of some type of control and power.
Not many.
No.
You know, I have 3 aunts that went to this school. Did you know that?
I heard.
And there was that one time at that one church that we went to that you came with me and they asked if you were related to, whatever, your John Nance, your dad. Remember that?
I do.
Yeah. But this show is not about me. This is, I'm interviewing you here, so I'm going to just stop talking about that.
That's the rumor, yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to go to the next question.
I'll wait here.
Okay. If you say you aren't a part of this show that we are here discussing things on, why are you on the opening thing, and also why are you in the credits?
Truthfully, I have good contacts and friends. They decided, okay, we'll let you be in the opening credits, and we'll even put your name up there. And it's a really good thing that they're doing for me. It helps promote my song that I wrote. It's called "I'm Okay, You're Fat."
I'm fat.
No, that's the song in the title. Excuse me. It's based on a novel that I did not write. It's called "I'm Okay, You're Fat." And basically, what it is, it's a new method of losing weight. Basically, you have to close your eyes and light a few candles, saying, you're chanting, "Let go away, fat, go away," something like that. But being on the show, on the credits, fine. I'm on the show. I'm one of the producers. It happened.
Not sure if you should have told him that. You know, here's what I was thinking. You know, I'm on the show quite a bit, every other week, and I have kind of a big part in it, yet I was not put on the opening thing, and I do show up in the credits, my name is there, you know, at the very, very bottom. You know, being the good person you are that has all the connections that you have, I was thinking that you would have possibly been able to get me in that opening part, or in, you know, maybe a bigger part in the credits, but you didn't do that.
Sadly enough, my friend, before I hired you, we taped all that. We taped that, I think, a whole week before I contacted you.
I'm not bitter about it.
Good.
But we thank you for coming and being interviewed on your show.
Well, yeah, you're welcome.
And I think you know what part of the show this is. This is the part where I reach into the desk here and pull out a marker. Do you know what to do with it?
Write
on yourself.
Okay, I'll do my best.
I was hoping that you would sign this beautiful board for us before you leave. That would be marvelous.
Most people are signing the same foot and a half diameter here. I'm going to sign another thing. Not my thing.
He said that most people sign in the same foot and a half diameter here. He's going to sign somewhere else. And you probably can't hear him. Thank you very much, Mr. Jack Nance.
One to talk to. You are there for me. You are there for me.
Grand old chap, that Jack. Just to inform you, Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat is coming on April 25th, 26th, and 27th in Herrick Auditorium. Now we go to our man who can hold a mic in his hand and stand at the same time. Here's Ryan Evans with Wide World of Humans.
Mr. Evans, your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to seek out strange and unique talent around Southern Nazarene University. Good luck. This tape will self-destruct.
us is going to be doing a pretty interesting trick. Can you tell us what your name is?
My name is Corey Clifton, and I am a freshman here.
And where are you from?
Minco, Oklahoma.
All right. And what are you going to be doing for us today?
An old trick of the families. My uncle showed me it, and I call it the hovering pea trick.
All right, sounds interesting. Go ahead and get yourself ready.
Thank you.
talk about beautiful, her song was cool too. Well, well, Mr. Jeffrey Whitehead has found for us a relevant story to inform us because we are all on the edge of our seats. My people, search.
Some men search for good, others search for fame. Me, I crave an obvious thing, for I seek out the truth. You're watching the search.
Hi, I'm Jeff White, and today we're going to be going down to the India Shrine Temple to learn more about the Shriners.
Can you tell me a little bit about what the Shriners are about?
The Shrine actually started back in the old, in 1922, there was about 15 or 20 businessmen from New York City that they were lawyers, doctors, entertainers, and what have you, that had social lunches, dinners together. And they came to the subject one time about children that didn't have money for medical purposes or, you know, for hospital and what have you. So they thought, well, let's get something organized. And they did. And they started finding children with orthopedic or burns or something like this. And they started to help them. No cost to them. All the transportation, all the medical, hospital and everything. Well, it got to where it was getting to be a pretty big operation. So they thought, well, let's find somebody could sponsor us, you know. So they thought, well, we get a Masonic lodge. The man's voted on, accepted 32 times. He should be a pretty good fellow, you know. So that's how the Masonic and Masons got into it. To be a Shriner, you have to be a 32nd degree Mason. And now we have, here's your hospitals over here. We have 22 hospitals. We have four burn centers at Galveston, Cincinnati, Boston, and just in the last couple of years, they built a new hospital in Sacramento, California. Our first hospital was built in 1922 in Shreveport, Louisiana, which is the strip on the top on the upper left-hand corner, which that building there was rebuilt in 1987. And it takes care of anything orthopedic, bones, club foot, bow legs, cerebral palsy, or anything. If anything's orthopedic, maybe deformity of hands or anything. The Option Hospital is a burn hospital, or Boston and Cincinnati, and like I said, Sacramento. In our hospital in Chicago, that's a spinal cord. And we have one patient we send in to Montreal, Canada, on a bill of bone disease. But this is at no charge. We don't care what denomination, what a person is or anything. There's no charge on the medical or anything.
So do you guys mostly just do fundraising for the hospitals, and or do you have like separate charities?
Like you said, you're a Shrine Circus. Mm-hmm. The Shrine Circus, we use the Shrine Circus every year. On our India mosque here, we have 42 different units. Myself, I'm a Legion of Honor, that's military. We have, just like in the Legion of Honor, we have an ice cream trailer that we take to the fairgrounds all the time, the horse shows or different functions, you know. And just like at the Fair of the Heart, and we have our own ice cream cone makers, the waffle iron, and then we do good. We make pretty good money on that. Mm-hmm. And all this money is we put into the transportation fund, the fan funds. We have the clowns, we have the caravans, you have the horse patrol, you have, like I say, 42 different units. Each one of these units. Fundraisers and everything. Mm-hmm. We never did used to ever go out and advertise what the Shrine is. A lot of people didn't know, like I said, you looked at before. The Shriners are a lot of people, just the ones that have a parade and have a good time, I think. These things just have the crazy red fezes. And the fez came into it was back at the beginning, we had one of the entertainers that I was talking about that was in New York, and the original bunch was over in Europe, and he was at a party or what have you there, and they had an ambassador out of Morocco that happened to be wearing the fez. And he thought it looked pretty nice and everything, so that's how the fez got into the shrine. There's nothing on the religious part of it. But like I say, on the shrine, we have from every church that you can think of, there's shrines. And we spend about $1 million a day just on research in the hospital.
How far spread is the shrine?
We are all over the United States, Panama, Canada, and Mexico. We have shrine all over the world, but I mean that's where we have our different temples in these shrines.
When did the Oklahoma chapter first start?
The shrine in Oklahoma. I've been a shriner since February of 1946, and it was way before my time. But here's just like I'm reporting this out of this temple here. We have 2,418 patients on our program. We have active patients as of right now, 887. But you might notice across the street, we have that new garage over there. We have 10 vans that we transport children and their parents to the hospitals at no charge. One of our vans, we use those for Houston, Galveston, Shreveport, and every once in a while St. Louis. Biggest part of the time we fly on those commercial airlines. They're in the hospital.
What do you do to become a Shriner?
Well, you have to be a Mason. Like I say, you're a professor of belief in God, and it's just a Masonic organization that's they say it's a secret. The only thing that's secret about it, a lot of people say they are Masons or something. We have a certain word or certain grip. That'd be a secret part of it. But I mean, everything in Masonic is based on the Bible. And it's like I say, from any denomination. And as of the last couple, in the years past, like I said before, you had to be a 32nd degree Mason to be a Shriner. Now you can go through the Blue Lodge, which is the first 3 years, and be a Shriner. You know, just like anything, you know, a lot of the old Shriners are dying off. We're getting kind of old, you know. I'm like myself, I'm 78 years young, you know. And hope to be around here a long time yet. We still agree that a younger people have to be 21 years of age.
What can you tell me about the little red cars?
Oh, the little cars, they have little caravans. It looks like our vans. Now here's can't tell too much about our vans up here. But they're just like little babies' deals. And you have your motorcycles, and you have your, they just have anything and everything. It's crazy, you know. But it's charitable. We do a lot of things for a lot of people.
Well, that's it for the Shriner story. Back to you, Owen.
That's a Jim Dandy documentary you got there, Whitey. Now I present to you my absence. I'm leaving. Next week, Madam Cox will be with you in presence, but I will be here in spirit. Now here is, once again, Ryan Evans with Strangers with Candy.
Got candy? Today we're going to find out if these TV people know much about their commercials on a special SNU Variety edition today on Strangers with Candy.
I'm Jeff White, and I'm host of The Search.
I'm Chase Buchanan, and I'm the host of Jock Talk.
My name is Les Dart. I'm instructor of speech communication. I'm also the studio manager, so I'm in charge of Channel 22 and SNU Variety ultimately.
Do you watch much TV?
No, not a whole lot. Whenever
you watch much TV?
No, actually, I don't watch very much. I watch a little PBS. That's about it.
I'm going to give you a product's slogan. Can you tell me what product it is? Hungry? Why wait?
Snickers.
All right. Once you pop, you just can't stop.
Greet each other with what word?
Well, let us put it in one word.
Wawa!